Christian Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Bible Promises and Prayers for Children, Releasing Your Child's Divine Destiny, by Bill and Beni Johnson with Abigail McCoy. Narrated by Scott R. Pollak. May our sons flourish in their youth like well-nurtured plants. May our daughters be like graceful pillars carved to beautify a palace. May our barns be filled with crops of every kind. May the flocks in our fields multiply by the thousands, even tens of thousands, and may our oxen be loaded down with produce. May there be no enemy breaking through our walls, no going into captivity, no cries of alarm in our town squares. Yes, joyful are those who live like this. Joyful indeed are those whose God is the Lord. Psalm 144, verses 12 through 15, New Living Translation. Your child is a treasure. Each child is a gift from God that we, parents, grandparents, and caregivers, are commanded to treasure. This is both our greatest joy and our most sober responsibility. In light of this, Bible Promises and Prayers for Children is intended to nourish you, as well as the children in your care. Each entry begins with a short teaching message, includes related scripture to meditate on, and concludes with a guided prayer. Beni and I hope that listening to this book will become a time of encouragement as you connect to God's heart for your family and beyond. In each entry, we have also created a section where your children can participate with you. Together, you can discuss the questions we offer. Then, you can invite your kids to pray with you, make a bold declaration of faith, and engage in the suggested activity. Our prayer is that this would provide an opportunity for discovery and connection between your family and your Heavenly Father. May this book lead you and your entire household into encounters with the Almighty God so that your family might impact the world with His love, power, wisdom, and purity. 1. Training up a child. God focuses His loving attention on those who belong to Him. Hebrews says that the Lord disciplines the one He loves, and He chastens everyone He accepts as His son. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 6, New International Version. God longs to impart His holiness and peace-filled righteousness to all His children, and He has given us the authority and responsibility to impart identity, character, and purpose into the lives of the children in our care. When we walk kids through healthy discipline, we are investing in them. We are reorienting them into an awareness of why they are alive and into the fullness of their inheritance. But this kind of discipline requires godly wisdom. It needs to be an occasion, not an outburst. Real discipline takes time. The strength of our discipline comes from our ability to respond to a child rather than reacting to his or her behavior. And that means allowing ourselves to be inconvenienced sometimes. We all know that children can act out at the most awkward moments, in the grocery store, at a dinner party, in front of guests, and, naturally, parents can find themselves either ignoring bad behavior or reacting angrily to put a stop to it. But neither of these produce the fruit we want to see in our children's lives. If we take the time to invest in the moment of discipline, it will spare us much disappointment and pain later. God's discipline comes from a heart of love, and we model that for our children, shaping their hearts with responsibility and purpose. When we take the time to discuss with them what they did wrong, we are able to make sure they understand their misstep. We give them time to adjust their attitude and take responsibility, and we deliver an appropriate correction if needed. We get to approach our children with humility and love. Godly discipline is never done out of frustration or vindication, but with tender care. We are raising children to become adults, leaders, and parents. Partnering with them for their future success as they grow will impact them for the rest of their lives. For meditation. For the Lord's training of your life is the evidence of His faithful love. And when He draws you to Himself, it proves you are His delightful child. Fully embrace God's correction as part of your training, for He is doing what any loving father does for his children. For who has ever heard of a child who never had to be corrected? We all should welcome God's discipline as the validation of authentic sonship. For if we have never once endured His correction, it only proves we are strangers and not sons. Hebrews chapter 12, verses 6 through 8, NIV. He who spares his rod hates his son, but he who loves him disciplines him promptly. Proverbs chapter 13, verse 24, New King James Version. You are witnesses, and so is God, how devoutly and uprightly and blamelessly we behaved toward you believers, just as you know how we were exhorting and encouraging and imploring each one of you as a father would his own children, so that you would walk in a manner worthy of the God who calls you into His own kingdom and glory. 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 10 through 12, New American Standard Bible. For prayer. Lord, fill me with your faithful love, so that when I need to redirect blank, it comes from that tender place. Help me delight in your discipline in my own life, so that I can accurately represent your heart to blank when I bring correction. Thank you that you care enough about us to invest in training us in the ways that we should go. Thank you that you mark us with identity when you discipline us. Holy Spirit, help me bring discipline promptly, but patiently. Give me God's wisdom to know when to correct and when to tenderly encourage. Thank you for the destiny that you've given, blank, God. Thank you that you are faithful to equip those whom you have called. I will remind, blank, of who you have created this child of yours to be. For time with your child. Ask, how do you feel when you are disciplined? Everyone needs training so they can become their best selves. What areas of your life do you feel as if God is helping you grow in today? Pray. Holy Spirit, remind me how amazing you think I am even when I mess up. Thanks that you always love me the same no matter what. But help me to keep growing, Jesus, so I can be more like you every day. Declare. I have a powerful destiny. I am important enough to God that He cares about training me. Do. What kinds of gifts and talents has God put inside you? Discuss with each other the call of God on your life and what kinds of character attributes you will need to fulfill that calling. 2. Prophesy their destiny. One of the core beliefs of the Christian faith is that God still speaks. It would be impossible for us to be born again otherwise. God called us to Himself, and we responded with surrender. Refer to 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 9. God longs to speak to us about our lives, and especially about the lives and destinies of our children and grandchildren. He has specific insight into the design of each child, and learning to hear Him in this way can make all the difference in our homes. Zechariah prophesied over his son, John the Baptist, when the child was only 8 days old. Refer to Luke chapter 1, verses 67 through 79. The baby was too young to understand consciously what his father was saying, but prophetic words reveal the heart of God, and the heart of God must be declared. In 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verse 1, we are told to desire earnestly spiritual gifts, but especially that you may prophesy. New American Standard Bible. The point is, not only is it legal to pursue specific gifts of the Holy Spirit, it is commanded. As parents, we need this prophetic gift in a big way. Prophetic insight is essential for raising children. God has a unique purpose for each child, and we can help our children discover that purpose. The Bible tells us, train up a child in the way he should go, even when he is old, he will not depart from it. Proverbs chapter 22, verse 6, New American Standard Bible. The verse says, in the way he should go. It does not say we should train up a child in the way we want him or her to go. Our job is to plant the seeds in our children's lives and then cover their lives with prayer. Prayer brings the water, so to speak, and it is God who will bring forth fruit from the seeds we have planted. For meditation. Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I set you apart. Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 5, New International Version. And you, child, will be called the prophet of the highest, for you will go before the face of the Lord to prepare his ways, to give knowledge of salvation to his people by the remission of their sins, through the tender mercy of our God, with which the day spring from on high has visited us, to give light to those who sit in darkness and the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the way of peace. Luke chapter 1, verses 76 through 79, New King James Version. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future. Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 11, New International Version. For prayer. God, I need your insight into blank's destiny. I want to speak life, truth, and identity over blank. Will you give me a vision for your plans for blank's life? Thank you that you have planted gifts, skills, passions, and dreams in this child's heart. Help me call those out prophetically so that blank can walk with confidence the path of life that you have laid out. I need your wisdom, Lord, to guide me as I empower and correct blank. Help me fan the flames of who blank is, while providing godly correction. I want to see this child the way you do. For time with your child. Ask, what do you love to do? Why do you think God might have built you with those specific passions and interests? Pray. Thank you, God, that you created me with special gifts, talents, and passions to bring to the world. I will keep listening to who you say that I am. Declare. God knows every part of me. He has special things to say to me about my life. Do. What do you think God loves about each person in this room? Take some time to tell each person what you think God would say about him or her. 3. God is good. You will not be able to exaggerate God's goodness. You can twist, dilute, or redefine it, but he is better than any of us think. And because of this, we must change the way that we think and speak to our children about this foundational attribute of the Lord's goodness. Scripture says God is good, so we must believe it. But then, why do bad things happen? Throughout history, people have credited God with many horrible wars, natural disasters, and diseases because of his omnipotence and the idea that he is in control of everything. Although it is true that he is in charge, it is not true that he is in control. God designed the infrastructure of the world to include our free will and our choices about things that affect the outcome. For example, Scripture tells us that God is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 9, New King James Version. Are people perishing? Yes. Is it his will? No. He gives each person the free will to choose his or her eternal outcome. As parents and grandparents, we should be able to relate to this particular distinction between God being in charge and God taking control. We are in charge of our homes, but we are not always in control over everything that happens there. God has written us into his plan as co-laborers for his kingdom. In this context, our children must learn how to explore the depth of God's goodness and dream big. Because he has invited us to partner with him creatively on the earth, we have an obligation to pursue God-sized dreams that only he can fulfill. You are helping raise a generation who will know God as such a good father that they will dream with confidence about the redemption of the world. Because Jesus called his disciples friends, he invited them to ask whatever they wanted of him. Refer to John chapter 14, verse 13. This was not an invitation to selfishness or greed. It was an acknowledgement that their hearts were so connected with his that he wanted to co-labor with them to see heaven come to earth. This is the mindset, set on the foundation of God's goodness, that we want our children to inherit. For meditation, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Psalm 107, verse 1, New International Version. Everything we could ever need for life and complete devotion to God has already been deposited in us by his divine power. For all this was lavished upon us through the rich experience of knowing him who has called us by name and invited us to come to him through a glorious manifestation of his goodness. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 3. O taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who trusts in him. Psalm 34, verse 8, New King James Version. For prayer. God, thank you that your goodness is integral to who you are. Thank you that we can trust that your goodness and love are wrapped around us at every moment. You have invited blank to experience your goodness daily and learn to trust your heart. Help blank receive your love and mercy. Pursue your heart and explore the realms of your goodness past where I have gone. Help blank dream huge God-sized dreams with you, Father. For time with your child. Ask. Jesus only did what the Father told him to do. What kinds of things can you see in Jesus' life that reveal God's goodness? Pray. God, thank you for being such a good, good Father to me. I want to become more aware of your goodness every day. Holy Spirit, would you remind me of God's goodness whenever I forget? Declare. God's goodness is extravagant, and it is pointed right at me. Do. Take some time to talk about some personal testimonies of God's goodness. Build your faith together as you see what God is able and wanting to do. 4. Nothing is impossible.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.